All right, so everybody present your result. So I hope most of you learn a lot from your classmates' sharing, right? And what I want to show you today is first I will discuss your homework and just show you something may interest you. But I will use your images. So if there is any privacy concern, please let me know. I will delete my image from my slides. Because the copy of the slide is publicly available, you know, right? I have a course website and I upload the slides to the website. And I will show you how to use Kebuflow. So some of you had tried it already. But I think most of you haven't. But the Kebuflow is our research center's, I should say, resource. So it is very helpful for most of you. And we will go to deep learning from this course. Okay, so this is the table about the statistics of our homework one. Most of frequent one is the detection, so it is very interesting. Most of you want to study this topic. And the second is classification. So some people want to classify the vehicle plate character on it, or baby sleeping action, or traffic light, or even facial expressions. And the third and the fourth share the same frequency. They are hand gesture recognition and 3D geometric transportation. And the remaining three topics only pursued by some of you. Okay. So what I want to show is all of them are covered by our textbook. So if you are interested, read those chapters. And I hope you will gain knowledge from the textbook. Okay, so since most of them are recognition problem, so see the first, the second, third, and the fifth are all of them. So let's take a look of the recognition chapter of our textbook. So you can see there are classification problem, detection problem, segmentation problem, and the image understanding problem. So I want to show you what is the topic of recognition. So the definition of recognition is you to know something, okay? And so there are many tasks. The first one is classification, and it is almost the fundamental one because for segmentation problem, you can view it as I want to classify each pixel, which class the pixel should belong to. Or for the detection problem, okay, it means given the image and given a bounding box, you can draw a lot of bounding boxes on the image, but given a bounding box, can you ask what class of the given bounding box? Oh, if I crop a region from the image, so will the data within the bounding box belong to certain classes? So it is also a classification problem. So identification, so it means given a data set and given a new instance, is the instance the same or very similar to some existing instances in a data set? So this is also a classification problem. So you, from your homework, you can replace the X on any object like a finger, print, face, apple, car, traffic light to those categories. And post-animation is not a classification problem. It is we want to estimate the, I said, given a model and an image, we want to estimate the position or the pose of the model in the image. And because most of you are interested in recognition problem, so I want to mention the recognition problem has been started for many, many years, but DAN, deep neural network, gives us a very powerful tool to improve its performance. So if we want to, I should say, the state of the art method, and now you are in year 2023. So understanding deep neural network is an essential knowledge for you to I should say, study the recognition problem. Okay, so this is submitted report of two of your classmates. Okay, they are doing hand gesture recognition problem. And I found a very interesting thing is they are very smart. They know how to use the very useful tool to do their homework. So the tool is media type. This, okay, so this is a media type. Okay. Where is the media pipe? Right, okay, so this is a media pipe. Okay, it is a library. And the library covers many topics you can use. And this is the flowchart to do a gesture detection task. At first, the library will detect whether there is a palm in the image. If there is a palm, then the algorithm will detect, okay, where it will crop the region from the image and use a post-animation method to estimate where is your fingers and where is your hand. Okay, so in fact, the library includes two steps. The first is detection problem, and the second is post-attenuation problem. So this is the flowchart. It can be generated by the media pipe library. Okay, so if you go to media pipe's website, you can see it covers those problems, and it provides pre-trained models for each of the problems. Okay, I think the best way to introduce the library is let each developer to introduce the library. It will be very clear. Okay, let's see a short video.
Hi everyone, my name is Chang and I'm a developer advocate at Google. Today, I'd like to introduce you to MediaPipe, a low-code, no-code framework to build and deploy on-device machine learning solutions across platforms. If you are interested in integrating machine learning into your mobile, web, or IoT applications in just a few lines of code, then this session is for you. I'll start with showing you what MediaPipe is and how you can use MediaPipe to integrate on-device machine learning into your applications in just a few lines of code. Then I'll wrap up with a sneak peek of our future plan, such as our exploration into on-device generative AI. Let's get started. So what is on-device machine learning? On-device machine learning is a kind of machine learning that runs entirely on user devices, such as smartphones or web browsers, without sending user data to the server for processing. You probably have used some kind of on-device machine learning before. For example, many magical features in Google Pixel are powered by on-device machine learning, such as the Magic Eraser feature that allows you to erase photo bombers from your photos, or the live caption feature that transcribe audio playing on your phone in real time. On-device machine learning has been a difficult engineering problem. For example, let's take a look at a seemingly simple machine learning task, hand gesture recognition. It takes an image as the input and returns hand gestures found in the image. Here, it detects a thumbs up gestures with 63% confidence. Although it seems simple, this task actually requires four different machine learning models chained together. The first one detects hands from the image. The second one detects the hand landmarks. The third one creates an embedding vector of the gestures, and the fourth one classifies this embedding as a thumbs up. On top of it, there are many other things that you need to take care of, such as how to run the whole pipeline efficiently on GPU, or how to deploy it on very different platforms, such as Android and web. The good news is MediaPipe abstracts all of this complexity and offers you low-code and no-code tools to get started with on-device machine learning easily. We do that by focusing on a specific set of common machine learning use cases and provide easy-to-use on-device solutions for them. We have 14 solutions available today, and hand gesture recognition is one of them. MediaPipe is built on top of TensorFlow Lite, which is Google's official framework for on-device machine learning inference. Each solution in MediaPipe contains one or more TensorFlow Lite models, and MediaPipe provides a pipeline that chains the model together for you. The MediaPipe solution for hand gesture recognition has already done this pipelining work for you, so you don't need to worry about orchestrating all these models. You only need to interact with a simple API, fit the input image in, and get the prediction result out. Next, let me show you the MediaPipe API in more detail. To integrate the hand gesture recognition solution into your app, you will need to use a library called MediaPipe Task. This is the calling code that you will need to write. The first step is to create a gesture recognizer object. You need to specify the model bundle that you want to use. This model bundle contains the four TensorFlow Lite models that are needed for this solution. Then you define the input image. Here I use an Android bitmap object. And finally, you call the recognize function on the input image. Here's the recognition result object. You have a list of gesture objects, each representing a potential type of gesture found in the input image. And if you also have a web app that you need to integrate this solution, then no problem, you can do it very easily. This is the JavaScript code that you should add to your web app. It follows the same flow as in Android. Input image in, detected gesture out. Very easy, isn't it? You may wonder, what are the platforms that MediaPipe currently supports? Well, we already have support for Android, web, and Python. iOS support is coming soon. And if you wonder what solutions we provide today other than hand gesture recognition, then you can check them out easily in MediaPipe Studio, and let me show you how. MediaPipe Studio is a web app. If you go there, you will find a playground where you can try out all on-device machine learning solutions from MediaPipe right in your web browser. Of course, you can try out the hand gesture recognition solutions in MediaPipe Studio. You can see that it can recognize thumbs up, thumbs down, or victory gestures in real time. This solution can recognize single hand gestures today. We're adding support for two hand gestures, and you will see them coming soon. Let's try another solution, image segmentation. MediaPipe offers multiple off-the-shelf models for this solution. One of them is a selfie segmentation model that can differentiate between a person and the background. It's a kind of model used in Google Meet to blur or change your background in video conferences. We're excited to announce a new segmentation solution that can segment more general objects that it hasn't seen during the training process. This solution takes an image and a point of interest as the input, then it gives you a segmentation mask that distinguishes the object at the point of interest from the rest of the image. For example, given this input image, you can click on the dog or the person to segment them in the image. Let me show you another one, face landmark detection. This model can detect more than 400 different landmarks on your face. We are excited to announce a new feature in the face landmark detection solutions that gives you 52 blend shape scores representing different facial expressions such as open mouth or raising eyebrow. This technology helps you create virtual avatars that mimic humans' facial movement. You can find this demo and its source code in the video description. KDDI is a telecommunications company in Japan that wants to innovate the entertainment experience with XR and 5G. They are experimenting with this MediaPipe technology in their product. They use a local computer running MediaPipe to capture a human performer's facial expression and transfer it to a high-quality 3D virtual avatar in real-time. Then it's combined with real-time pulse detection to recreate the whole virtual performer in 3D. The performance is then live-streamed to viewers through Google Cloud. MediaPipe isn't limited to just computer vision domains. We also have text and audio solutions, such as text classification or audio classification. Please go to MediaPipe Studio if you want to explore what kinds of magic you can create with on-device machine learning. In MediaPipe, we put a lot of effort in creating new on-device machine learning solutions that just work out of the box. However, we also know that in many cases, you need to customize the solutions to fit your own use cases. Let's take the hand gesture recognition solution as an example. The off-the-shelf model can recognize 7 different types of gestures, as I show here, but they don't include gestures like rock, paper, or scissors. So if you want to build an app to let users play the rock, paper, scissors game with a computer, then you will need a way to customize the hand gesture recognition solution. The good news is that you can easily do so with MediaPipe Model Maker. Many of you may find this product sounds familiar. Yes, you're right. MediaPipe Model Maker follows the same concept as TensorFlow-lite Model Maker, but it was built entirely from scratch to be a low-code library to customize solutions provided by MediaPipe. Let me show you how to use Model Maker to create a custom hand gesture recognizer that can recognize rock, paper, and scissors gestures. You need to start with collecting a training dataset with hands showing rock, paper, and scissors gestures. Once you have the dataset.
Okay, let me pause this here. So you see the library provide a method to let you train your own model. And this is an opportunity to do your homework 3. Right. So there are many ways. So this might be a very easy way to do it because they prepare everything. You just need to provide your data. But I'm not sure how many images they need. You need to figure it out by yourself.
You can start using Model Maker to train a custom model to recognize these gestures. Model Maker is a Python library, so you can use Google Colab to train model faster using Colab's free GPUs. First, you need to import the gesture recognizer module. Then it loads a rock, paper, scissors dataset and start training the custom model. After model training has finished, you can use the test dataset, which the model hasn't seen during the training process, to check the accuracy of the model. And finally, you can export it to deploy on-device using MediaPipe Task. You may wonder why the exported model has a .task extension but not .tflite. It is because this hand gesture recognition solution requires multiple TensorFlow-lite models, so this .task file is actually a bundle containing multiple TensorFlow-lite models and some metadata. After you have your custom model bundle, you can upload it to MediaPipe Studio to try it out right away. You can see that the custom solutions can now recognize rock, paper, and scissors gestures. Deploying the new custom solutions on Android is very easy. You just need to replace the off-the-shelf model bundle with the new custom model bundle that you have just created using Model Maker. The rest of the code stays the same. We've made a rock, paper, scissors game as a web demo using this custom model. You can find the URL of the demo and its source code in the video description. Try it out and see if you can beat the computer. I hope the rock, paper, scissors example gave you an idea of how easy it is to build a custom on-device machine learning solutions using MediaPipe. Today, you need to write some Python code to create custom solutions, but we're working on adding a no-code customization tool into MediaPipe Studio. Soon, you will be able to upload your training data to Studio to create custom solutions without writing a single line of code. On top of the features that are already available today, we're actively working on some exciting new features that will push the limit of on-device machine learning. Generative AI has been a hot topic gaining significant interest since the end of last year. Today's generative AI models, such as Imagine or Lambda, are still gigantic, so they are not yet suitable to run on device. However, we found that a technique called model distillation can be used to distill those general-purpose large models into smaller models that can run on device and specialize on a certain number of tasks. We are excited to announce an experimental on-device solution that allows you to stylize faces in images.
So I want to pause here again. As you can see, the video was uploaded to YouTube this May. It is very new. So he talks about the future plan, so we don't know whether the new feature has been released or not, because this is an ongoing project. So there are many new features possible, and you need to check their website by yourself.
Push the limit of on-device machine learning. Generative AI has been a hot topic gaining significant interest since the end of device. However, we found that a technique called that can run task. For example, you can use this solution to transform your photos into cartoon style. This solution supports customization, which means you can prepare a few style examples, such as anime faces, and use Model Maker to create a custom solution that can transfer any faces to this style. Please only use this solution on your face or faces of people who have given you permission to do so. Another generative AI model that we're running experiments with is diffusion-based image generation model. We were able to generate images from a text prompt on a higher-end Android phone within a few seconds. We're working on reducing the model size so that it's more suitable to be used in actual apps.
So, sorry, I paused again. So this is your homework for to generate images from text. So the library will maybe very useful for some of you.
Stay tuned for more updates. We're also doing experiments with on-device text generation solutions. We were able to deploy a large language model on Android that can help you do several tasks with natural languages, such as summing up a long conversation or writing a formal email from a given topic. On-device generative AI is in its early days, so there are still many technical challenges we need to overcome to make them ready for production. Stay tuned for our updates in the coming months. So there was a lot of content that we covered today. Before we wrap up, let's recap the most important topics. MediaPi provides you off-the-shelf on-device machine learning solutions that you can easily integrate into your mobile or web apps in just a few lines of code. MediaPi Studio allows you to try out these solutions right in your web browser so that you can come up with ideas about how on-device machine learning can be integrated into your apps. Many of these solutions can be customized using your own dataset, and MediaPi Model Maker is a low-code Python library you can use to customize MediaPi solutions. If you want to learn more about MediaPi, check out our website at developers.google.com/MediaPi. Thank you for watching, and don't forget to subscribe to our TensorFlow.
Okay, so I think you have noticed the speaker mentioned the MediaPi's backbone is TensorFlow Lite. And what is TensorFlow? TensorFlow is Google's machine learning framework. It is a backbone. And so the MediaPi, so its backbone is Google's TensorFlow Lite, and its goal is to make people easy to use machine learning tools, machine learning inference engine. So it supports many platforms, many hardware devices, CPU, GPU, and it supports many languages. Let's take a look. There are many different backbones. Okay, so TensorFlow is here, okay? And TensorFlow, it is very big. And TensorFlow Lite is the simplified version. It allowed users to run the platform on embedded devices. Okay. And PyTorch, I think some of you are very familiar with this backbone because it is widely used. If when you use our AI centers platform, the default option for you is PyTorch. Okay. And Keras is a library based on PyTorch. It makes users more easier to train the model. Just use fewer commands. Okay. And all right. But of course, there are some backbones. They were very popular in the history, but now they are obsolete because of the new backbone. I should say, the big company supports their own backbone. So, for example, Cafe. Here, I once used it in 2017, but now almost no one is still using this backbone. And I also use the Torch. The two backbone I use now are obsolete already. Okay. Oh, all right. Two of your classmates worked for hand gesture post estimation, right? In addition to hand gesture post estimation, they are human post estimation. So, of course, they serve for different purposes. Okay, if you want to recognize someone's movement, the hand gesture is not useful. The whole body action will be the information I need. So I want to show this is the 3D pose. So there are at least two types of pose animation, 2D and 3D. 2D means I don't want to know the depth. I just want to know where is the body part in the image. But so let's take a look of the 3D first. So no, doesn't work. Doesn't work. Okay, maybe this is an older friend. So let's take a look at the 2D post animation first. This is the 2017 CPR Oro. Do you know the difference of Oro and the poster paper? Let me slide this. So remember, there is a figure I show you. So every year, there is a number of accepted papers. This year is around 1,000 papers or etc. Okay, for the CPR conference. And they will select around 5%. Area chair think, oh, this is the best paper in my pile of papers. They will select it and give the authors the opportunity to present their study in the audience, on the audience. So everybody will listen, pay attention to the work. So this paper in that year is the state of the art. Okay, so let's take a look. So the significance of this paper is it is the first method can generate a real-time result. So the frame per second is almost 30 frames. So in 2017 based on the GPU they can get. Okay, so this means the method significantly reduced the computational time for the problem of 2D pose estimation.
Don't believe me, just why? Don't believe me, just why? Don't believe me, just why?
Okay, so the first challenge is the scale changes a lot. And the second challenge is there are many people in a frame, and the number is not fixed. So what they do is, first, they detect the component of the landmarks one by one. Okay. So you can see the left knee, the left ankle, etc. Okay, then they try, hi, yes. No. This is a camera-based method. They have the video. No matter is it captured by what camera. Okay. Okay, then they connected the adjacent landmark.
On this night of NBA stars, Giannis Antetokounmpo and Jabari Parker must feel the eerie familiarity to last season's game in December. Once again, the Warriors come to Milwaukee with a winning streak immediately following a Friday night victory in Boston. Nobody on the court wearing a Warriors uniform is a defending champion.
Okay, so this is an interesting part. Okay, their algorithm, of course, will make some mistakes. So pay attention to, because their arms are closed-handed. So you will see, he thinks this is her arm. But in fact, her arm is this way. Oh, so this is my mistake. So In the first course, I show you a reference book written by Prince in 2012. Okay, I will show you it later. Okay, so what is the research? Deep neural network provide a method to predict human posture, human pose in the image, right? It is a probability problem. So, see here. So, we are human. We clearly know the arm here belong to this lady. But for computer, they don't. They think the highest probability is this way. Okay, so this is why even before deep neural network has been developed, computer vision researchers, they have developed a probability model to predict things in image. So that's why I will show you the second reference book. Okay, in that book, no deep neural network is mentioned because it was written in 2012. Okay, but there are many probabilistic models available in that book. Okay, so let's take the 3D case. It works. So what I want to mention is, if you want to get 3D information, usually you need multiple cameras. So you see here, there are many cameras standing around the person. Okay, but for 2D pose information, just one camera is enough. Right, and see, this is 2018. Just 1 year later, new method has been developed for the same problem, and this is doing research. So you see in previous video, they can estimate the location of the joint or key point, but in this paper, they can estimate the direction. So let's take a look. So this is the dense estimation, the same video, right? But different result. Okay. In this method, they not only know the location, the position of the location, they also know where is the, surface of human body. Okay, once we have the information, we can they can replace their original curves with new surfaces. Okay, and I want to pause here. Pay attention. They didn't claim this is a real-time pose estimation. Because, see, if you want to calculate so many mesh, then you need a more computational time. So, the method may be slow, but it's very useful. Okay, so this when they have new skins, so this is the result. All right, let's stop here. Okay, the next page. Oh, okay, so this is the single view 3D construction problem. If you remember, it is started by Mr. Chai. Okay, so what are the problems? It is if just use the single image, you want to estimate the structure of your object. So in your textbook, you can find this example. The researchers only use one image, and they can estimate the depth and of the house. Because the house, the structure of the house is relatively simple. There are a few faces, this faces, and this depth. So from that input image, they can generate images from another viewing point. Okay, so you can see from here. In the input image, the window is at the left part of this pillar. But in the new image, the window is on the left part. Okay, so that is what Mr. Chai wants to do in his homework. But however, and this paper was published in year 2000. If you are interested, you can take a look. Okay. But however, what I want to say, 3D reconstruction is a challenging problem. And in our textbook, all chapter 13 sections want to show existing method how to do it. So there are many different ways to do the 3D reconstruction problem. Okay, it's interesting to try it in your homework. But if you want to go deeper, take a look at this section. All right, so let's take a break. Right, I want to show you some figures from chapter 13. So figure 13.18, this is something very similar to the task to generate images from another viewpoint. So in this method, you can see the researchers prepared a model already, and they get color information and pass those pixels onto the model so that once they rotate the 3D model, they can generate images from different viewing points. Okay, this is another figure from chapter 13. So this is the same. But however, in this method, they need many images. So from here, you can see there are many pictures taken from taken at different locations, so that they can use those images to reconstruct the structure of the house, and then they can rotate the house to generate different images. So that is what Mr. Chai wants to do here. Given an image, he wants to generate images from another viewing point. Okay, so one of your classmates did his homework one for image mapping. But however, he only did image segmentation. They are slightly different. And this is the result. They are very good and very, I should say, useful. Why I say useful? Because this is my younger son's backpack. That's true, that's true. I took a picture 2 days ago at my home, and he loved the Mega very, very much. But the Mega originally is a product photo from this website, because the Mega is a model. It cost me $1,800. That's fine. Okay, let's talk. So what I did is, he wants a picture of the Mega, and but the white background is not elegant. So I replaced the background of a cosmetic image. I did the same thing as Mr. Li. So you can see what there is a strong, steady demand for beautiful, elegant images. Okay. Why I say Mr. Liu only did segmentation? Because after browsing his code, I didn't find any matching piece of code. He created a tool, a user interface, to generate allow users to manually select the region he wants. But however, there will be some artifact. If you see the pixels here and here, you can see many white pixels. So it makes the users, I think most users won't like it. Okay. The reason is this is his origin input image, and the background is almost white. And now he wants to pass the Mega onto a new background with very dark intensity, so there will be very high contrast. Okay. And in our textbook, chapter 10.4, there are many ways to deal with the problem, and the one developed very, very early is the blue screen matching. Just give a blue screen so that you can estimate the transparency along the boundary. And for Mr. Liu's problem, because the input image is taken by himself, so he can control the background. So if he wants, he can try the blue screen method. Okay. And I am wondering how well his new image will be generated. Okay, maybe he can do it in homework too. It's up to him. Okay. And OpenCV offers two matching methods. So these are the two functions he can call. Okay. But however, deep learning, once deep learning was developed, there are many new methods they can use the networks to generate the same or better results. So let's take for the two conventional methods, they require a trimap. And this method also requires a trimap. It is DNN based, but this method published in CPR 2021, very new, just 2 years ago. It doesn't require TriMap, so it is easier to use. So this is the paper published in CPR 2021, okay? If you are, so you can see there is a neural network architecture, okay? But I didn't go through all of the detail of the paper. If you are interested, in particular some of them who are interested in the affirmative problem, you can take a reference of this paper, okay? And two of you did the deal with the problem of 3D to 2D projection. Right? One of you try to handle the receipt. Another one, this is the SS tool, right? Just a film. Oh, just a film. Oh, okay. Yeah, good. Okay, so when I take a look of your reports, it reminds me of something. Okay, I want to show you.
Even though we've all gone digital, paper, that stuff made from trees, still lives on. At some point, you'll have to sign a contract, a rental agreement, or your taxes, and get it to the person who needs it. And face it, fax machines are all but extinct.
Right now,
if you don't own a scanner, or just want a faster way to get documents scanned and delivered, here's how to do it on your Android phone.
Some people had to address the problem. They want to use a cell phone or camera to replace a scanner.
There are plenty of apps that will let you scan and deliver documents, but my personal favorite is Handy Scanner. It's free, easy to use, and you can grab it from the Android market. To get started, tap the camera button here and grab the document you want to scan. Position it so that it fills the screen and make sure the document is in focus. When it's all set, capture it and continue the process for any other pages you might have. Now, drag the red dots around the document so that it fits snugly. Tap the arrow when you're done and it'll correct the perspective. This will fix any weird angles and make it look a lot more like the original. Now, check the document and decide if it needs any tweaking. You can tap this button to select any filters like enhancing the color or this print ready option that will make it look a lot better for printing. When the document looks good, tap this arrow here and you'll be asked to give it a name. Decide what to call it, tap OK, and it'll process the sheet. Now all you need to do is send it on its way. Tap the doc and select the JPEG button. Here, you can decide if you want to send it to yourself for printing or directly to the person waiting for your signature. You can also use Handy Scanner to scan your receipts and track your expenses.
So, yeah.
In any case, now you have a faster way to scan your documents and reduce the paperwork on your desk. For CNET.com, I'm Sharon Vackman.
So I also found another, because the Microsoft Office Lens, this is also a free app. Yeah. And this is was uploaded 2 years ago. So there are 9 year gap. And let's see what's the difference between the 9 years. So let's stop here. So you can see, after the 9 years, there are some new features, although the basic functions are the same. So what's the new feature? First, it can recognize characters from your handy script. You can recognize tables. And what is third? Video bits. I think it's some video manipulation effects. So what I want to next page. Okay. For one of your problem, receipt. Well, for receipt, convenience may be the most, if we want to capture some information from receipt, well, we can allow it is not accurate. But if we want to know the accurate locations on the field, it's very important because as your case report, this is a medical devices or something else. All right. So okay. So what I want to say, position or accuracy is very important for the medicine, medical diagnosis or something else. Okay. So if you want to replace a scanner by a camera, I think one thing we need to keep in mind is to collaborate the lens. Okay. Because for most cameras, there are some distortion problems. So the barrel distortion like this. So this should be a straight line. But after captured by the camera, it is slightly curved. Okay. And so another distortion is pincushion distortion. So it will move toward the center. And if you combine the two distortions, you will get the mustache distortion. So if you want to replace, if you want to generate a very accurate location of this point, whether your camera has the distortion problem, how to measure it? Okay. So there are some manufacturers, they sell the checkerboard. Okay. They also provide software to detect or to measure how much the distortion is. Okay. So for this example, given this image and then their checkerboard, they can evaluate or predict the distortion of the lens. Okay, and use their software, they can recover the shape of the image. So it might be useful for your application if you require very accurate location of your image. So this is a comparison. If you use a scanner, then you can control its light condition. You can know its location of your film or your document. And then you can control its measuring process. But if you are using a camera, then there are any kind of ambient light. And your hand or the document may change their position. And there are some factors that you may not be able to know because you are the user of the camera. So remember, this is the sensing pipeline. So there are many factors, the autofocus, auto-white balance, gain, and the sharpness. All of them are done by the manufacturer and you cannot control. Okay. So if you want to deal with the problem, pay a little attention to this. Okay. And two of you deal with the identification problem. You want to remove identification from the image or video. And this is the interesting research because in your report, you just blur the image. Watchers won't know who the person is. And in this video, they try to do the same thing, but use different way. They create a new face. Okay. So let's take a look. Okay, this is published in ICCV 2019. This is also a good, very good conference.
Large-scale face recognition is now a publicly available technology, enabling tracking and identification to be performed in real time. Recent world events concerning the advances and potential abuse of face recognition technologies invoke the need to understand methods that successfully deal with de-identification. In this work, we focused on the problem of de-identification, addressing these privacy concerns. The goal is to distance the identity of a given person, making that person unidentifiable to both humans and state-of-the-art face recognition systems. We propose a method for face de-identification that enables fully automated video modifications in real time. For each sample, the original video can be seen on the left, the de-identified one on the right. At first glance, the video might seem unchanged. However, the perceived identity, as expressed mainly by the altered nose, eyes, eyebrows, mouth, and cheekbones, is completely changed, while the pose, expression, and illumination conditions are left unchanged. We present our results on a diverse dataset in terms of gender, ethnicity, and age, dealing with occlusions and excessive motion.
It'd be like five to eight. When she would tuck me into bed.
Dressed up, usually she'll dress up, and now she's like, well, maybe we'll just, you know, order in. I go, no, I made dinner. And
that day, for no particular reason, I decided to go for a little.
Hello, ladies. Look at your man. Now back to me. Now back at your man. Now back to me. Sadly, he isn't me.
We applied a state-of-the-art face recognition network on the de-identified faces in a ranking experiment. Identification is performed out of the 54,000 persons in the ArcFace verification set. The table reports the rank of the true person out of all persons that the face recognition network produces. The ranking of the true identity in the original video shows an excellent recognition capability, with most of the frames identifying the correct person as the top one result, as seen in purple. For the de-identified frames, despite the large similarity between the original and the modified frames, the rank is typically in the thousands, as seen in green. We apply an additional face recognition network, benchmarking our method's ability to impair the true positive rate, which is the rate of correctly recognizing two images of a person as of the same person, while one image was de-identified. The rate drops from almost 99% to less than 4%. This method is the first to be demonstrated on video, as it is the only one to preserve the expression, pose, illumination conditions, and produce natural-looking faces. A comprehensive comparison with previous methods can be found in the paper. To provide further intuition as to what it means to distance the identity of a person, we demonstrate our ability to control the hyperparameter lambda. Given the source image on the left, the incremental shift in the identity can be observed as a progress to the right, which correlates with a stronger lambda. The architecture is based on an adversarial encoder-decoder coupled with a trained face classifier. A rich latent space is achieved by concatenating the face classifier representation layer, which is the face descriptor. The network requires a single image per video.
Okay, let me explain something here. So you know its target. They want to allow users or watchers to, okay, this looks like almost the same, the solidity. But however, they want to cheat classifier, because in 2009 or even now, many classifiers are developed to classify, okay, which the person is the owner of the face, in particular for the celebrity. So from here, for our human beings, we still think it's very similar. I didn't see any difference. But for classifiers, they will fail. Okay, so that's what they want to do.
And does not require retraining for new identities. A masking process blends the source and generated image, creating a seamless generated image. A multi-level perceptual loss ties the generated low and mid-level abstraction layers with the source, while maximizing the high-level distance. Please refer to the paper for additional details, experiments, ablation studies, and comparisons. Thank you for your attention.
All right. Okay, so for identity problem, we can identify people by their faces, right? This is another research direction. They want to identify people by their whole body. Okay, so let's take a look for this video. And I will not go through to the end because the video is slightly long. Okay.
Hello, everyone. Today, I'd like to introduce person re-identification. What is person re-identification? It is frequently used in this scenario. For example, if we want to track a prisoner who just escaped, given the raw image sequence, we use person detection to detect the people in one image, and given the prop image, find the most similar people in the gallery. It is usually used when face recognition fails, because it is using the global feature instead of the face feature. It is less accurate than the face feature. We can hardly find any same faces for different people unless they are twins, but there are a lot of people wearing similar clothes. It happens a lot because for a face recognition system, we need at least 96x96 face image to get a reliable prediction, but in video surveillance system, we usually cannot get such a high resolution face. Person re-ID usually depends on clothes, figure, and accessories. The hard part is to find the same person in another camera because we have already lost sight of the person. It is used for short-time forensic because if the suspect changed clothes, it can hardly identify the same person. Person tracking can also rely on person re-ID. If the person keeps moving, we need to find the same person among different frames. There are several classes of person tracking. First, single camera, single target is relatively easy, and we don't necessarily have to use person re-ID for tracking. We can simply use common filter for tracking. Multi-targets rely more on person re-ID, as person re-ID is to tell different people apart. The most challenging and widely used case is multi-camera, multi-target. For example, we need to associate the same person from four different cameras. And person re-ID must be used because the trajectory has been lost among multiple cameras. We cannot use motion models alone anymore. From data aspect, we have original video frames, the video captured from the camera. We also have target person images. Detect all persons in the video frames, extract features for all prop and gallery images, then measure the similarity. After measuring the similarity, return the most similar ones. They are more likely to be the target person. In research, usually person detection and person re-ID are two separate topics. Researchers will directly use a state-of-the-art person detector or human label bounding box. However, in real scenario, we consider person detection and person re-ID as a whole. There are several steps for person re-ID. First of all, is to learn the robust feature of a person under different cameras, regardless of illumination and pose change. Second, learning the mapping to new domain so that the same person has shorter distance. Thirdly, sort the distance according to feature and return top K results. There are several common features of datasets for person re-ID. First of all, the datasets usually measured is usually manual labeled or detected by state-of-the-art person detection algorithms. It's independent from person detection. Usually, the dataset has training set, gallery set, and query set. Training the model based on training set, and then extract feature from querying gallery, and then calculate the similarity. For each query, return the top n similar images. Fourthly, in training and testing, there is no overlap of person IDs. There are several commonly used datasets for a single frame. There are CUHK03, Market 1501, Duke MTM Serie ID, and MSMT 17. There are thousands of person IDs and hundreds of thousands of bounding boxes. And we also have sequence-based datasets such as LPW, MARS, LVRID. Also, it provides thousands of person IDs and tens of thousands of tracklets and even millions of bounding boxes. The difference between sequence-based dataset and frame-based dataset is how they are labeled. Single frame dataset, each image is labeled as one person ID, and sequence-based dataset, each tracklet is labeled as one person ID. There are several challenges of person re-identification. For example, low resolution, occlusion, angle and pose variance, and illumination change. In conclusion, it is big difference among intra-class and small difference among inter-class. There are several metrics for measuring the person re-ID models. First is rank K. It's in the retrieved list, the hit rate in top K results. For example, for this case, for rank 1, 2 queries have been hit, so it's 2 divided by 5, it's 40%. And for top 5, there are 3 hits, so it's 60%. And for top 10, there are 5 hits for 5 queries, so it's 100%.
All right, let's stop it. So you, do you understand the definition of the problem? So in this building, there are many surveillance cameras, right? And if I walk from this classroom to somewhere, and I will be captured by one of those cameras, and is there a system can understand this is me, and now I'm going to somewhere else? So if the re-identification algorithm is well designed, then it would be very useful for a security system. Okay. And also, this is person re-identification, right? Let me mention something. Do you know car re-identification? Because on the closed road, there are a lot of surveillance camera. And if there is a criminal and he drives the car and he goes somewhere, can the police officers use a re-identification system to know, all right, I know the location of your car now? Okay, so got it? So that is the, I should say, value of the algorithm. All right, now we finished the discussion of our homework one, and I want to show you how to use our Kebuflow platform. So this is the URL. Once you click it, and it will go to the website. And see, this is Andy Smith. He's a virtual student. Okay. I created the account just for ensure all of you can access the platform. Okay. Okay, once you key in your password, get in, and then click the dashboard here, and here, log in with LDAP, and log in again. Now you can see there are notebooks here, and create your new notebook just by clicking the new notebook button. And then there are some darker images existing already. They are created by other courses. And for you, click the advanced button and then give it a name. Say test 10, 5, 10. Select image. Okay, if I use this one and specify the CPU and the RAM you want to use, say I want to use 4 CPUs and the memory size is 16 giga and the GPUs. The GPUs is useful for your homework 3 and 4. Say if I want to use 2 GPUs, specify its vendor, okay? Then how many mega do you need for your storage? I think for this is test, so 10 is enough. And then just launch it. Okay, then see this circle running. This is a new test. Wait for a while. And now you can connect. Okay, if you see this error, this is fine. Because the new instance is just running. So wait for a few more seconds and reload it. Okay, now it works. Click the connect. Then you will see a remote desktop. And you can install, because you are root, see the root here, right? You can install any software programs you want. But keep in mind, install those programs in your home directory. Otherwise, because this is a Docker instance, it will, the all data will be removed after the instance was shut down. Okay? And if you want to shut down the instance, click the square here, and it will shut down. Okay. And if you have no interaction with the system for 30 minutes, your instance will automatically be shut down. Okay. So that's the brief introduction. And in addition to the remote desktop, you can create Jupyter notebook. So select another image. So for example, this is Jupyter notebook. Okay, give it another name. Test 2, right? And specify it. 4 CPUs. 12 giga memory, and if I don't need GPUs, that's fine. Oh, fine. Give me a GPU. And launch it. Oh. What's this? Oh, it's fine. Okay. I see the number is very, very large. Oh, something wrong. Right. Stop. Something wrong. Okay. By the way, if you allocate too many giga memory or too many GPUs, exceed the capacity of the system, you will see the circle keep running, and it will not end. Okay, so let's stop. Let's do it again. Something wrong. Okay, that's the 3. And 8. All right. 1. Okay. And the launch. Okay, now it looks good. All right, okay, connected. The default user interface, I forgot to change the image. Right, I forgot to change it. So my image is remote desktop 2. Oh, sorry, let's do it again. Jupiter and because it is CPU based, so I skip the GPU setting and just launch it. Okay, test 4. Stop. Alright, connect. And wait for a while, reload it. Okay, so the default user interface will be a Jupyter Notebook. Okay, so you can do, if you are familiar with Jupyter Notebook, so you can do your own to create your notebook. Right, so let's close the, So there are some existing darker images, and the one, remote desktop V1.0.2 is the simplest one. This is only the laptop, and if you want any software programs, install by yourself. Okay. And this one, let me explain what's the difference. This ROS, it means a robotic operating system is pre-installed. Like I think we don't need it. And for example, this image, database design. So the image was created by another course for the database design, etc. So my suggestion is use this one if you want to create a remote desktop. And there are some small issues. If you use that remote desktop, you will see some Chinese user interfaces. For most of you, of course, there's no problem. But for some of you, you may not know what it means. I have notified the admins of the system, and they will create another darker image full of English user interfaces. But we need to wait for their response. Okay, so next week we will have the project pitch, right? Okay, and because we have only 150 minutes in total, so and we have 5 teams, so please restrict your pitch to at most 28 minutes. Okay, and because we have class breaks, there some of your pitch will be paused. Interrupted by the class breaks. And remember, all of you are judges. And this is the grade sheet. There are 4 columns you need to fill in your grade, your opinion. It's clearness, completeness, feasibility, and significance for your proposal, your pitch. And every class, all of you will submit your grade sheet to the e-learning system so that I can collect all of those points and calculate the final grade of your pitch. And you don't need to grade your own team, okay? Just grade other teams, right? Okay. Now we are going to some deep learning courses, and I will use Justin Johnson's lecture because he is an expert in this field. Okay, and let me mention something at first. Justin Johnson was a Stanford instructor for 3 years, and this is the life expense and tuition fee at Stanford for a graduate school student and engineering college. So for 1 year, the total cost is around 2.6 million New Taiwan dollars. Expensive. And now Johnson & Johnson is a professor at the University of Michigan. Also, the cost for a graduate student is around 2.6 million dollars, New Taiwan dollars, per year. Okay, and this is the online resources for you to learn deep learning. Okay, so Stanford offered this course because Justin Johnson was the TA in 2015, and then instructors from 2017 to 2019. The course is instructed by Fei-Fei Li at Stanford, and Fei-Fei Li was the primary organizer of the ImageNet dataset, and you will see what the property of the dataset later. Okay. Once you click the website, you can see its slides and its lecture videos. But the year is 2017, around 6 years ago. And Justin Johnson offers his lecture videos and slides at the University of Michigan in 1920. So it's around 4 years ago. Okay. But however, I checked the content almost the same, but only slightly different. And I will show my comments for those updated slides. Okay. So, okay. I download those videos from YouTube. And if you want to see subtitles, YouTube offers the automatically generated subtitles. For some of you, may be useful. Okay, and at YouTube, you can control the speed. Okay, so that's what I mentioned earlier. For the last most is your textbook. And this is a free reference book you can download. The deep learning book focuses on, of course, deep learning. And it is also the textbook used in Justin Johnson's course. And this is the book I mentioned in the first class. Because the book was published in 2012, so there is no deep learning in this book. But however, what deep learning is going to solve? It is a machine learning problem. This book mentions a lot of machine learning problem. The only difference, it doesn't use neural network. So this is a conventional machine learning problem. So you can see its subtitle is models, learnings, and inference. So now let Justin Johnson talk
a little bit from these two topics. Computer vision and machine learning both fall within the purview of the larger research field of artificial intelligence. So artificial intelligence is very general, very broad. It's broadly speaking, how can we build computer systems that can do things that normally people do? So that's kind of my definition. I think people will argue about what is and is not artificial intelligence. But I think we just want to build smart machines, whatever that means to any of us. And I think there's clearly many different sub-disciplines of artificial intelligence. But two of the most important, clearly again in my biased opinion, are computer vision, teaching machines to see, and machine learning, teaching machines to learn. And these are the topics that we'll study in this class. So then kind of where does deep learning fall in this regime? Deep learning would be a subset of machine learning, and it intersects both computer vision and falls within the larger AI realm. I think it's important at the outset so then this class is going to focus at kind of this intersection right in the middle, the intersection of computer vision, machine learning, and deep learning. The reason I want to start out with this slide is because it's really easy to get caught up in the hype these days and think that computer vision is the only type of AI. Deep learning is the only type of AI. Deep learning is the only type of computer vision. But I think none of these are true. There are types of AI which have nothing to do with learning, nothing to do with deep learning. There's classical results about symbolic systems and other approaches to AI that are very different technically. There's areas of computer vision that do not use any very much machine learning or very much deep learning. So even though the focus of this class will be the intersection of these different research areas, I just want you to keep in mind as a whole that there is a much broader realm of AI research being done today around the world by different groups that falls into different pieces of this pie chart. And of course, there's many other areas within AI that we won't talk about too much. So there's natural language processing, things like speech recognition, things like robotics, and I kind of ran out of space on the chart to put any more sub-areas. Suffice to say, artificial intelligence is a massively popular area of research and area of study these days. That, again, with the broad goal of making machines do things that people normally do, you can imagine that there's a whole lot of things that we might do out in the world that fall under this umbrella of artificial intelligence. So that's kind of the big picture roadmap. And now for the rest of the semester, we're going to focus on this little red area in here. But again, don't forget that there's a lot more to the world than what we're talking about in this class.
Remember there are three circles. And let's go back to our textbook. So the textbook covers the computer vision circle. And the deep learning covers the this circle. And the third book, Computer Vision, published 10 years ago, covers this circle. You can, without the computer deep learning. So the three books serve for different purposes.
More and more uses of machine learning, more and more uses of data in order to improve our visual recognition systems. So one hugely influential piece of work here was the Pascal Visual Object Challenge. So here they downloaded a bunch of things because now it's 2000. Larry Roberts had exited computer vision and invented the internet. So we could then download images from the internet to help build these data sets of images, and then we could get graduate students to go and label those images.
So here, Justin Johnson is talking about the history of computer vision. So see, deep learning was developed widely used after 2012. Before 2012, there are still many algorithms trying to solve computer vision problems. So let's take a break. Alright, so some of you may not be familiar with what pitch is. It's not a pitch. Okay. So let's see an example of what pitch is. Okay.
Revolutionizing.
So this is the pitch in Silicon Valley. They want to get venture capital funding. So they
the way people organize themselves, share knowledge and information by reinventing online collaboration.
So they have a lot of money.
And to help me explain why our users log into 2D every single day, I'd like to share with you a quote by Theodore Adorno. The task of art today is to bring chaos into order. Now, although we're not great artists like Jackson Pollock, we are bringing order to the chaos of online collaboration tools. But before I explain, one of the most ancient human activities. Now the tools we use, they remain the same for hundreds of years. It took us centuries to finally combine these tools into one awesome, glorious machine, the combine harvester.
So they will show a lot of details.
Although I have no idea, if we can people today suffer from the complexity.
Okay, so you will see there are several teams.
To-do solves the issue. Facebook. We empower these teams in every chat. We have to CTO at Spill Game.
you don't need to wear a dress. Because this is classroom. This is not the real, this is the, not the funding pitch. This is just a presentation for your plan of the term project. Okay, now, all right. So what Justin Johnson want to tell his students is, before deep neural networks, there are many existing machine learning methods addressing computer vision problems. Okay. So that's going on.
And then you could use your machine learning algorithms to mimic the labels that the graduate students have written down on the images. And then if you do that, then you can see this nice graph on the right of performance increasing on this recognition challenge, increased steadily over time from about 2005 to 2011. So then this brings us to the ImageNet large-scale visual recognition challenge. So here, this was a very, very large-scale data set in computer vision that has become hugely influential and has become one of the main benchmarks in computer vision, even leading up to this day.
Okay, so this is the ImageNet data set that I mentioned earlier. It was, I should say, created by Fei-Fei Li, but not by herself. Okay, she has like idea, because there is a existing data called WordNet. WordNet means given a word, and what's the connection or relationship between other words? So it becomes a net. So Fei-Fei Li was a professor at that time. She was in the university at New Jersey. What's the name of it? No. Princeton, right, Princeton. Okay, she was in Princeton. And since there is a WordNet, can we apply the idea for images? So he created the ImageNet. But in the beginning, there's a problem. How to find a lot of people to label those images? You can download those images from internet, fine, but who should label this? At that time, Emeron Mechanical Turk was launched. So she and her PhD students just hire a lot of Turker. Okay, just pay them. Once they get fund, they have a lot of money, and they can hire a lot of Turkers to label those images. So that's the reason why she and her teams can create such huge data set, because they utilize Turkers.
So the ImageNet classification challenge was this fairly large data set of more than about 1.4 million images, and each of those 1.4 million images were labeled with one of 1,000 different category labels. And the big new piece of innovation here was that, if you kind of do the math here, you're going to need a lot of graduate students to label all this stuff. So the big piece of innovation here was to not label data using graduate students. Instead, this made use of crowdsourcing. So here, you could go on services like Amazon Mechanical Turk, and then parcel up little pieces of work, and then blast them out on the over the internet. And then people anywhere in the world could label a couple images, get paid a couple cents for each image they label, and that was able to massively increase the amount of, this is beneficial in two ways, right? Because one, researchers get people to label their data without being constrained by the number of graduate students that they have. And two, it became a nice source of income for some people who were bored at work and just like label images a little bit. Or bored in class, as the case may be. I don't know. It's still running, by the way. You can go up and try to do some tasks now. But anyway, this became a hugely influential data set and for computer vision. And more than a data set, it became a benchmark challenge. So they had, every year, they ran a competition where different researchers would compete and try to build their own algorithms that would try to recognize objects in this classification challenge. And this became somewhat jokingly known sometimes as the Olympics of computer vision. that there was a period of time from maybe in the late 2000s, early 2010s, when people would just really excitedly want to look at the results of the ImageNet competition every year and see what kind of advances the field had made in the last year. So then, given that I told you it's this competition, you can look at what was the error rate on this competition moving over time. So the first time the competition was ran in 2010 and 2011, we were seeing an error rate of around 28, around 25. And then something big happened in 2012. So at the 2012 ImageNet competition, suddenly the error rates dropped in a single year from 25% all the way down to 16%. And then after 2012, error rates just kept on diminishing very, very fast, such that once we got to about 2017, we were building systems that could compete on this ImageNet challenge and perform even better than humans when they try to recognize images in this data set. So then the question is what happened in 2012? So what happened in 2012 is that deep learning came onto the scene. And this was really the breakthrough moment for deep learning. And computer vision researchers suddenly woke up and saw that there's this crazy new thing that is suddenly sweeping our field. So in 2012, there was this absolutely seminal paper from Alex Kuchevsky, Ilya Sutskever, and Jeff Hinton, where they proposed a deep convolutional neural network called AlexNet that just crushed everyone else at the ImageNet competition that year. And for people working in computer vision at that time, this was shocking. This felt like there was this...
Okay, let's pause here. So see the professor, Hinton, okay? He took his contribution. He and another two professors won the Turing Award in 2018. So Turing Award is similar to the Nobel Prize in the computer science community, all right? And by the way, for your homework two, it's okay to keep going on your homework one research and show us your progress, your improvement. It will be very amazing. Okay. But remember, I think all of you use images and videos captured from camera, so it's fine. Okay. So that's. Keep going on.
This brand new thing that just came out of nowhere and just suddenly crushed all of these algorithms that we've been working on. You know, as we kind of watch this history of computer vision, walking from the 1950s all the way up until the 2000s, you'll notice that neural networks were not a mainstream part of that history throughout much of computer vision's history. So when this suddenly appeared, it felt to a lot of computer vision researchers like this was this brand new thing suddenly appearing all at once. That's this brand new exciting technology. And that was a little bit flawed because this was not a brand new technology. There had been a parallel stream of researchers going back similar amounts of time that had been developing and honing these techniques for decades. And 2012 was the sudden breakthrough moment where all of that hard work paid off and became mainstream. So then let's talk a little bit about the history of deep learning, kind of going back in time yet again. So then, about the same time that Hubel and Wiesel were doing some of their seminal work on visual recognition in cats, there was another very influential algorithm called the perceptron. So the perceptron was one of the earliest systems that could learn as a computer system. But what's interesting is that this was, 1958? So the idea of an algorithm, the idea of programming a computer, these were quite novel research topics on their own at that period in time. So the perceptron was actually implemented as a piece of hardware. Here's a picture of it on the right. That is the perceptron. It was this giant, like, cabinet-sized thing with, like, wires going all over the place. It had weights that were stored in these potentiometers, which I don't even know what that is because I'm a computer scientist. and these weights were just mechanically up. The values of these weights were changed mechanically during learning by a set of electric motors, which again, I'm not a mechanical engineer, so I definitely could not build this thing. But even though this was this mechanical device that was bigger than a person, it actually could learn from data somehow. And it was able to learn to recognize letters of the alphabet on these tiny 20x20 images that were super state-of-the-art in 1958. I don't want to talk about any of the math for the perceptron, but if you were to look at it with modern eyes, we would probably call it a linear classifier that we'll talk about next week on Wednesday's lecture. So this perceptron got a lot of people really excited. It got people thinking like, wow, here's a mechanism that allows machines to learn novel stuff from data without people having to explicitly program how it's going to work. And all of that kind of came to a crashing halt in 1969 when Marvin Minsky and Seymour Papert published this infamous book called Perceptrons in 1969. And what Minsky and Papert pointed out in their book basically was that perceptrons are not magical devices, right? The perceptron is a particular learning algorithm, and there's certain types of functions that it can learn to represent, and other types of functions that it cannot learn to represent. In particular, they pointed out that the XOR function is not something that is learnable by the linear perceptron learning algorithm that we'll talk about again a little bit more next week. And this sudden realization, well, okay, so the normal story that gets told is that the sudden realization of this book was that, oh, these learning algorithms are not magical, there's things they can't learn, and people just lost interest in the field. And work in learning, work in perceptrons, kind of dried up for a period of time following the release of this book. But what's interesting is that I think nobody actually read the book, because if you actually read it, there's sections where they say, yes, the original perceptron learning algorithm is quite limited, and it can only represent certain functions. But there's something else. There's another potential version of the algorithm called a multi-layer perceptron that actually can learn to represent many different types of functions, and it's very flexible in its representations. But that kind of got lost in the headlines at the time, and nobody realized that, and people just heard that perceptrons didn't work and were dead, and people stopped working on them. So you should definitely read the assigned reading. But then, going forward quite some amount of time, we skip ahead to 1980, and there was this very influential paper called called the neocognitron that was developed by Fukushima, who's a Japanese computer scientist. And he was directly inspired by Hubel and Wiesel's idea of this hierarchical processing of neurons. Remember, Hubel and Wiesel talk about these simple cells, these complex cells, these hierarchies of neurons that could gradually learn to see more and more complex visual stimuli in the image. So Fukushima proposed this computational realization of Hubel and Wiesel's formulation that he called the neocognitron. So the neocognitron interleaves two types of operations. One were these computational simple cells that, if we were to look at them with modern terminology, they look very much like convolution. And the latter was these computational realizations of complex cells that, again, under modern terminology, look very much like the pooling operations that we use in modern convolutional neural networks. So what's striking is that even back in this neocognitron from 1980 had an overall architecture, an overall method of processing that looked very similar to this famous AlexNet system that swept in 2012. Even the figures that they have in the papers look pretty similar, so they gotta be the same thing, right? But what was striking about the neocognitron is that they defined this computational model. They had the right idea of convolution and pooling and hierarchy, but they did not have any practical method to train the algorithm. Because remember, there's a lot of learnable weights in this system, a lot of connections between all the neurons inside. They need to be set somehow. And Fukushima did not have an efficient algorithm for learning to properly set all of the free weight parameters in the system based on data. So then a couple years later, there was this, again, massively influential paper by Grumelhart, Hinton, and Williams in 1986 that introduced the backpropagation algorithm for training these multi-layer perceptrons. So remember that in the perceptrons book, there was this thing.
So I'm going to pause here, okay? Because you see the name Hinton, okay? In 1986, and his colleagues proposed the backpropagation method. This is the foundation for deep learning, because there are many parameters in a deep learning model, how to update them. So because of the backpropagation method, so once we have data in the image set, we have model, and we have GPUs, researchers can use backpropagation to update those parameters to get high classification rate. Okay, so that's the reason why AlexNet is mentioned by Justin Johnson in 2012 was proposed or it was written by Hinton's team, because Hinton was the expert in neural networks. Before 2012, there are some very famous computer vision researchers, such as Michael Jordan, not the basketball player Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan was a professor at UC Berkeley. He didn't believe Hinton's suggestion. He didn't believe neural network will make a revolution for computer vision community. However, because of ASP.NET, then a lot of computer vision researchers started to use neural network. Okay. And the foundation was even proposed. So 2012 to 1969, 26 years ago. And you will see something similar later. Yang Lakun, okay, he is also the Turing Award laureate. His method, LaNet, is very, very similar to AlexNet.
Called a multi-layer perceptron that was thought to be very powerful in its ability to represent and learn different types of functions. Well, in the backpropagation, in this paper that introduced the backpropagation algorithm, was one of the first times that people were able to successfully and efficiently train these deeper models with multiple layers of computation. And this looks very much like a modern neural network that we're using today. That if you kind of look at this paper and open it up and read through it, you'll see they talk about gradients and they talk about Jacobians and Hessians and all this kind of mathematical terminology that we think about today when we're building and training neural networks. So these look very much like the modern fully connected networks that we still use today, that are sometimes called multi-layer perceptrons in homage to this this long history. So now that led to a lot of people, that led to a lot of small people started to get really excited about neural networks again, and try to think about different types and structures of neural networks that could be built and trained, powered by this new backpropagation algorithm. And one of the most influential works around that time was Yang LeCun et al.'s paper in 1998 that introduced the idea of a convolutional neural network. So this looks, again, very much like the Fukushima algorithm that we saw. Well, basically what they did here is they took Fukushima's kind of idea of convolution and pooling and multiple layers inspired by the visual system and combined that with the backpropagation algorithm from Rumelhart's paper in 1986. And with that combination, they were able to train this convolutional, these fairly large, at the time, convolutional neural networks that could learn to recognize different types of things and images. And this was a hugely successful system. It actually was very successful commercially. So in addition to being a piece of very influential academic research, it was also deployed in a commercial system by NEC Labs. And for a period of time, this convolutional neural net system developed by that group was actually being used to process the handwriting in a lot of checks that were written in the United States at that time. One figure that I found stated that up to 10% of all checks in the United States were actually having the numbers on the check being read automatically by these convolutional neural net systems in the late 90s and early 2000s. And again, if you look at exactly what this algorithm is doing, Lynette was kind of like the algorithm here was called Lynette after Yann LeCun. I don't know, he's French. And then that if you look at the structure of that algorithm, it looks very similar, almost identical to the types to the algorithm that was used in AlexNet nearly 30 years later. So then, emboldened by the success, there was, again, a small group of people throughout the late 90s and early 2000s who were really interested in trying to in push neural net systems and figure out ways to train neural net systems that were ever bigger, ever deeper, ever wider, and could be used on an increasing variety of tasks. And around this period of time in the 2000s was where the term deep learning first emerged, where the term deep was meant to refer to multiple layers in these neural network type algorithms. So this was really not a super mainstream research area at this time. there was a relatively small number of research groups and a relatively small number of people studying these ideas around this time. But I think a lot of the fundamentals that we're reaping the rewards of now really developed during this period of time in the 2000s, when people started figuring out all the new modern tricks to train different types of neural network systems. So that finally brings us back to AlexNet. And then in 2012, we had this great confluence of this great this computer vision task called ImageNet that people in computer vision were super excited about. We had this set of new techniques, convolutional neural networks, and efficient ways to train them that had been developed by this parallel research community. And everything just seemed to come together just at the right time in 2012. So then from 2012 to present day, we've seen an absolute explosion in the usage of convolutional and other types of neural networks across computer vision and across other types of related areas in AI and across computer science. So here on the left, we have the Google Trends for Deep Learning. So that shows you this massive sort of exponential growth that really took off starting in 2012. And on the right, this is a photo I took at the Computer Vision and Pattern Recognition Conference this summer in 2019. So this is one of the premier venues for academic publications in computer vision. And here is a graph that they were showing at the keynote for that conference, where they showed on the x-axis the year of the conference, and on the y-axis the number of submitted and accepted papers in this conference. So you can see that even though the last 5 to 10 years have resulted in this massive explosion, both of machine learning systems, both maybe in popular perception as measured by Google Trends, as well as a massive increase in academic interest into both machine learning systems and computer vision systems, as evidenced by this plot on the right. And if you look around the field today, we see that convolutional networks and other types of deep neural networks are being used for just about every possible application of computer vision that you can imagine. So from 2012, these convolutional networks are really everywhere. They're getting used from such a wide diversity of tasks, like image classification, where we want to put labels on images, from image retrieval, where we want to retrieve images from collections, things like object detection, where we want to recognize the positions of objects and images while simultaneously labeling them. The right one should be image segmentation, I need to fix the slide, where we want to label where this is going back to this idea of semantic grouping we saw from computer vision in the 90s, where we want to label the types of pixels as being part of a cohesive whole. ComNets are getting used for things like video classification, activity recognition. They're getting used for things like pose estimation, where you want to say how are the exact geometric poses of people arranged in images. Even for things that don't really feel like classical computer vision, like playing Atari games, where they would process the visual input of the Atari game with a convolutional neural network and combine that with other sorts of learning techniques in order to both jointly learn a visual representation of the video game world, as well as how to play in that world. Convolutional neural networks are also getting used for visual tasks that are about visual data that humans aren't very good at. So convolutional networks are getting used in things like medical imaging to diagnose different types of tumors, to diagnose different types of skin lesions and other medical conditions. They're getting used in galaxy classification. They're getting used in tons of scientific applications, like classifying whales or elephants or other types of because there's this problem where scientists want to go out into the world and collect a lot of data and then be able to use images and visual recognition as a kind of universal sensor to make use of all this data that they collect and gain insights into their particular field of expertise that they're interested in. And we've seen computer vision and convolutional networks branch out into all these other areas of science and just open up and unlock lots of new applications just across the board. ComNets are getting used for all kinds of fun tasks, like image captioning. Like we can build systems that can write natural language descriptions about images. These are using convolutional networks. We can use convolutional networks for generating art. So we can make all these kind of psychedelic portraits, again, using convolutional neural networks. So then we might ask, what was it that happened in 2012 that made all of this take off? Well, I think the jury's out, and we'll have to see what historians write 50 years from now. But my personal interpretation is that it was a combination of three big components that came together all at once. One was the set of algorithms that we saw that there was a stream of people working on deep learning and neural networks and machine learning who had developed these powerful set of tools for representing learnable functions and for learning them with the backpropagation algorithm. we saw this the second stream of data that with the rise of digital cameras, Larry Robinson inventing the internet, and people developing crowdsourcing, we were able to collect unprecedented amounts of labeled data that could be used to train these systems. And the third piece that we haven't really talked about was the massive rise in computational resources that has been continually happening throughout the history of computer science. So one graph that I put together that I find particularly striking is looking at the gigaflops of computation per dollar as a function of time. So here on the blue, you can see these are different types of CPUs. Right? A CPU is central processing unit. It's the thing that's making all of your laptops run. And they get faster, but not that much faster over time. But starting in 2008, there was some really interesting development with GPUs, graphics processing units. So these were these special purpose pieces of hardware that were originally developed to pump out pixels in computer graphics applications. But around 2008, people started developing techniques to run generalized programs on these graphics processing units. And then over time, these techniques became more and more easy to write general purpose scientific code and mathematical code to run on these massively parallel graphics processing units. And then if you look at the timeline from 2006 to 2017 and look at the gigaflops per dollar of these graphics processing units, you can see that although this exponential Moore's law may not have held up for CPUs, it actually has been, we actually have seen exponential increases in GPU computing power over time, over the last 10 years. And if you look at maybe the and this has been striking even in the last couple of years. So if you look at the AlexNet system in 2012, he was using this GTX 580 GPU that was very, very exciting at the time if you were a gamer. And if you push it on to more recent cards, like the GTX 1080 Ti, or more recently a 2080 Ti, I gotta update the slides, more and more uses of machine learning, more and more
Okay, I want to add some information here. Okay, take a look at this. This is AlexNet, right? Do you see two streets? The first stream and the second stream. Why did the team of AlexNet need to design such a network? Why don't they just put everything together? The reason is GPU. Because and let's take a look of Justin's slides. You can see the chart. Okay. And this one.
A little bit from these two.
Now this one. Right, this one. And where is the
of computer vision that you can imagine algorithm. We're running the internet press, but haven't really continuing the gigaflops of computation per dollar as
over here. This is AlexNet. It was published. So, in that year, the best GPU they can get is GTX 580. It means they don't have sufficient memory to put all the network into a single GPU. So they need to use two GPUs. That's the reason why AlexNet have two streams. And because Justin Johnson's lecture was given in 2019, and I have an updated chart for. Okay. It was. This one. Okay. So this is up to 2020. Okay, and there are some new devices called TPU. It can calculate more floating operations rather than GPUs. Okay, and okay, this is today's result. I checked the price of the RTX 4090 from Cool PC in Taiwan. It's named Yuanjiawu, right? Okay. Okay, this is the price, and I calculate the giga float per data. So the latest one is, okay, the latest one is 46.9. And we see the chart, 46.9 is around here. Okay, so the trade is continue going up. So today is 2023, October 5th. 1 year later, 2 years later, 5 years later, maybe the trade will keep going up. So you will have more and more computational power, and it's become cheaper and cheaper. So that is one of the reasons. You see media pipe in the first class, right? Your cell phone. Now, this year is iPhone 15, right? 5 years will be iPhone 20. It will become more powerful. And it will become easier for users to run machine learning algorithms on their devices. And also some updated. See, this slide was used by Justin Johnson. And that is the state of the art in 2019. And now, this is the text to image generation in 2023. So, given a text, a sentence, we can generate a much better images right now. So this is just a difference for 4 years. So you can see the technical will change very, very quickly. And then in our homework 4, we are going to do something like this. And remember, because all of those techniques change very, very quickly. So the best way for you to catch those change or to update your knowledge is to learn from online sources rather than in class, because everything changes so steadily. And you see the slide, right? You see the slide here. This is the opportunity for you to learn those nuts, because just in Johnson's course, there are, I think, around 20 hours. It is impossible for all of us to watch his videos in class. Okay, so if you are interested in, let's just show you the content of his lectures. So this is how many lectures are there? 22. Okay, so each lecture lasts for 1 and 1+ hour. So there are more than 22 hours lecture. And if you are interested in some topics, for example, object detection, then you can just jump to the video and watch it. Now you have know the quality of the video, and because the site is also offered, so you can do it by yourself. Okay. All right, so let's go back to his introduction. And, So it's around here.
Completely parallel graphics cost units. And then if you look at the timeline from 2006 to 2017 units, it's exponentially held up for CPUs. We actually have seen over time, over the last 10 years. And if you look at maybe the Alex, and this has been Alex next, very, very exciting, like the GTX, then you can see that the cards we have even 5 years later are literally exponentially more powerful than the cards that we were using even in 2012. So I think that it was.
Oh, so this is his first video vector to introduce to deep learning. And then from his second lecture, there will be, technical knowledge about how to create a case file. So let's go to take a look there. Of course, because of the time limitation, we won't finish the lecture in class. And you can do it in your by your own. Okay.
Start with machine learning. And now, starting this lecture, we're going to talk about image classification. And we're going to start diving into the technical material of the course. And today, we'll see our first learning algorithm. So today, we're going to talk about image classification. So image classification is really a really important core task in computer vision, and really machine learning more broadly. So image classification is really quite a simple task to state. So what we do is our algorithm is going to take as input an image on the left, and then the output, the algorithm needs to assign a category label to that input image. So when we talk about image classification, we typically have some fixed set of category labels in mind that the algorithm is aware of. So in this example, maybe the algorithm is aware of these five labels, cat, bird, deer, dog, and truck. As the algorithm performs image classification, what it needs to do is simply assign one of these five labels to the image that it sees. In this case, is cat. So for all of us, this is a really trivial task, right? You can do this almost without thinking about it. You just immediately know that this is a cat when you look at the image. But for the computer, that's not so easy. And the main challenge in image recognition and image classification when we try to do it on machines is this problem we call the semantic gap. So for us, when we look at this image, we immediately recognize it as a cat. We get these perceptions of all these photons running, they hit our retina, they go through our brain, they go through a lot of complex processing, but we're not really aware of that consciously when we look at these images. Instead, we just kind of intuitively know what we see. But the computer doesn't have that kind of intuition. So when the computer looks at such an image, what all it gets is a giant grid of numbers. So for an image like this, it's just a giant grid of 800 by 600 by 3 numbers. Where at each pixel, we have a single color value represented with three numbers between 0 and 255. So the problem is that if you look at these grid of numbers, it's really not obvious at all that this grid of numbers should represent a cat. And there's no obvious way to convert this grid of raw pixel values into this semantically meaningful category label of cat. And what's even worse is that this entire grid of numbers can change drastically as we make relatively unassuming changes to the image. So for example, if we were to imagine changing the viewpoint of this image, maybe if we were to take an image of a photograph of this exact same cat from just a slightly different angle, then to all of us, we would probably recognize it, definitely would still recognize it as a cat for sure, and we would probably still recognize it as this exact same cat, because we could recognize the markings on its face and whatnot. But the problem is that due to this semantic gap, this difference between what we understand when we look at images and what is represented in this raw grid of pixel values, that if we were to make even a simple change to this image, like photographing from a slightly different angle, all of the pixel values would change in a very unintuitive way. And we somehow need to be able to design algorithms that are robust to these massive changes in the raw pixel values that can arise from relatively simple changes to the images themselves. So there's a lot more we need to deal with beyond viewpoint variation in order to perform image classification. We also need to deal with things like intra-class variation. So if we look at different images, different cats all look very different. And each of these different adorable cats all produces very different grids of pixel values on the raw sensor of the camera. So we somehow need to build our systems that are robust to these massive variations that can occur within categories. So there's another problem, which is sometimes we want to recognize fine-grained categories. So far we've talked about recognizing maybe cats versus dogs versus trucks, but depending on the task at hand, we might want to recognize different categories that appear very visually similar. So for example, if we might want to recognize different breeds of cats in some applications. So here we have different categories that appear very visually similar. And this is again a huge practical problem. And it's not clear at all how to write algorithms that are robust to changes in image pixels in this way. We also need our algorithms to be robust to background clutter. So sometimes the objects in the image that we want to recognize somehow blend into the background, maybe due to natural camouflage or other sorts of crazy things going on in the scene. We need our classifiers to be robust to illumination change. As we change the lighting conditions in the scene, turn on and turn off lights, take pictures in the dark, take pictures in the daylight, the underlying semantics of the images, of the objects in the images do not change. So our algorithms should be robust to these massive changes in different lighting conditions. So our algorithms need to deal with deformation. So the objects that, and maybe cats are particularly deformable object categories, but we need to be, but sometimes the objects that we want to recognize in images might appear in very different view, very different poses, very different positions in the image. We might somehow need to deal with occlusion. So sometimes the object that we want to recognize in the image might not be visible hardly at all. And I think this example on the right is really interesting, right? This is basically a couch, and we see a tail sticking out from underneath the couch cushion. Now, you probably intuitively thought that that was a cat, right? Because we've seen a lot of images of cats, because you know that cats usually live in houses, because you know that maybe cats like to burrow down under things sometimes. But actually, if you think about the evidence, in the raw image evidence on this image, we don't actually know that this is a cat. This could be a raccoon. This could be some other kind of crazy animal with a tail, right? So somehow, even this relatively simple problem of giving category labels to objects and images can involve a lot of common sense reasoning about the world. Your knowledge that cats live in houses and raccoons are unlikely to live under cushions of couches, right? So even this relatively unassuming problem of classifying images becomes very challenging very quickly if we want to recognize the full breadth of categories that exist in the world and all the variations and positions and appearances and changes and ways that those objects can appear in images around in the world. So if we were somehow able to overcome all of these problems and write down algorithms that could perform robust image classification and recognize lots of object categories in lots of different situations, it would be really, really useful. So we already saw in the last lecture how some applications of computer vision can unlock maybe many different scientific questions. So we could use image classification for things like medical imaging, medical diagnosis. Maybe we could take pictures of skin lesions and diagnose them as malignant or non-malignant tumors. Maybe we could take pictures of x-rays and try to classify what types of problems could exist in medical images. Robust image classification could be useful for astronomers who want to go out and collect visual data from telescopes and other types of sensors and then classify what types of phenomena are out there in the sky. These could also be useful for many other scientific applications, like maybe recognizing whales or categorizing many different types of animals that could appear in sensors. So image classification on its own is this really, really useful problem. And if we could solve it, it can unlock a lot of... So in object detection, what we want to do is draw boxes around the objects that in images and say not just what objects are present in the image, but where are they located in the image. And it turns out that image classification is itself a sub part that can be used to build up to more complex applications like object detection. So as an example, one way to perform object detection is via image classification of different sliding windows in the image. So one way to perform object detection is to just classify different subregions of the image. So we could look at a subregion over here and then classify it as background, horse, person, car, or truck. In this case, it's classified as background because there's no objects here. If we were to classify this box, we should classify it as person, et cetera, et cetera. So you can see that if we had the ability to build really powerful image classifiers, that would, again, let us build other applications like object detectors. Even something like image captioning is often framed as a classification, as an image classification problem. So here, the idea is that given an input image, we might want to write a natural language sentence to describe what is in the image. And here, this can be framed as a sequence of classification problems, just as in the object detection case. So here, we've got maybe some fixed vocabulary of words in the English language that the algorithm is aware of. And the question is, what word should I say next? And this is, again, a classification problem. So then first, we would classify and select this word man using an image classifier. Maybe select the word riding, select the word horse, and then select the word stop to mean that's the end of the sentence. So you can see that image, even slightly more outlandish application is playing computer games like Go. So people have built AI systems that can...
Okay, I want to stop here because we are going to finish the course today. I want to show you something else. Okay. Now, Justin Johnson is talking about the image classification. So we must have a classifier, right? And if you watch the videos by yourself, then you will find that he talks about the classifier, okay? And you can find related sections in this textbook. So for Chapter 5, it is the basic knowledge for machine learning. And the classifier is a traditional problem. Deep learning is just an approach. So there are many existing machine learning methods. Okay, for example, support vector machine, cluster, k, nearest neighborhood, etc. Okay. Okay, so, k-nearest neighbor and the support vector machine, both of the two methods will be introduced in Justin Johnson's lecture 2 and 3. And both of them belong to the supervised learning algorithms. So, when you watch his video lectures, you can also take a reference of this section. So, it will help you to classify what he's talking about. So, all right. So, see you next week.